this is what motivated me early on in my career when I was a pulmonary fellow, looking at the rising trends in asthma and seeing it disproportionately burdening lower-income ethnic minority populations, particularly in the inner city. And this is a smaller scale than what you were just seeing for California, but this is the Boston metropolitan area. And again, as you go darker, you see increased asthma morbidity, this looking at asthma hospitalization rates in this case as well. Also, those are the communities where they're lower SES, they're primarily ethnic minority, they're the ones that are being particularly impacted. Folks who live in inner city environments where they're more perhaps polluted may also be at increased risk of experiencing greater amounts of psychological stress. And that's really what we started to look at. How do these things co-vary? What are the independent contributions of the psychosocial factors? And also, how might the psychosocial factors even enhance the effects of the other environmental toxins? So looking more at the cumulative risk. These aren't new ideas, just to sort of let you know. We're not the first currently to think that psychological problems have a role to play in asthma. You can go back all the way to the 12th century. There's a treatise written on the role, the link between the mind and the body related to asthma. Actually, as early as the middle part of the last century, asthma was really thought to be something that was in your head. It was one of the seven psychosomatic illnesses called asthma nervosa. And then we sort of took a shift. We understood there's a huge component of asthma that's related to allergy, and we all started looking at the biology and the immunology of asthma, and really what we're trying to do now is try to bring those things back together. And this is shown here in this cartoon. There's a lot of evidence for the link between mind-body. Sort of anecdotally, we all understand it in ourselves. When we experience stress, we're more likely to get sick in different ways. And there's a lot of biology to show the connections between the brain, where you emotionally experience your and respond to the stressors that you're facing. And there's release of neurohormones and neurotransmitters that go systemically and can have broad health effects, including on the lung. And this cartoon just shows that there's a lot of evidence to suggest there's strong links in back and forth talk between the brain and the lung. Through the immune system, through the autonomic nervous system, through the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis and neurohormonal systems and connections with cortisol exposures and those sorts of things. And those are the things that we try to measure in our work to see if we can actually show these mechanisms are operating. And then to think that, well, what is health? It's an optimal balance of these key regulatory systems. And there's a lot of work in animal studies as well as human data now that suggests that in a lot of the environmental toxins that we talk about, whether we think about psychosocial stressors or many of the physical toxins like air pollutants, tobacco smoke, allergen exposures, they're all pushing on these systems. These systems, these key regulatory systems in the body, like to live in some optimal balance, and they're all talking back and forth to each other, so you can see how it starts to get complex. And when those are shifted over time, when you have chronic exposure to these environmental toxins, you start to see adverse health effects. So I just put that picture there because that's kind of what we try to keep in mind when we are developing our studies. So, well, we're all under stress. Why aren't we all sick? Well, stress in and of itself isn't necessarily bad, and we all need a little bit of motivation in our lives. So too little stress can actually also be have adverse effects. And there's some optimal level that each of us have our own, our tolerance level, our own ability to cope with. And it's when you're in a situation where you tip over, you're no longer able to cope, there are just too many stressors, they're cumulative, ongoing, they just never go away and you're living with them chronically. That's where you start to see adverse effects and you start to see shifts in these key regulatory systems and this imbalance. And this slide just says, well, we know that's true for stress. Stress can disrupt those pathways. But boy, if you get into the literature and you start to understand the science in these other fields of environmental health, you can see shifts in these same systems that some some overlap directly with how stress is operating. Some do these through different mechanisms. Tobacco smoke, ambient pollutants, allergens, they're pushing on those same systems. And so you can start to see additive or cumulative effects when you have co-exposures.